Person's asking, do you feel like the stronger your faith, the more trials you will face? Potentially. I mean, I don't know if it's a mathematical rule. I'm not sure that that's always what's going to happen, but I could definitely tell you that that is a trend that we see, right? To those who love God and follow him, there's always a trend of how it is that, you know, they will, because you have to understand, if you believe in God, you also believe not only in the power of goodness and the power of love, which is God, but you also believe that there is a devil out there who is trying to destroy us. You also believe that there is evil. You also believe that there is spiritual warfare. And whenever somebody moves closer to the kingdom and tries to establish a spiritual relationship, a real and authentic relationship with God, to want to be in union with him, the devil is not going to sit quiet. So obviously we have seen the trend of those who come closer to him, the harder they are fought. But we should not be discouraged by this. On the contrary, I want you to see it the same way that we understand athleticism. And by the way, the word athletic is the same word where we get ascetic. So askesis in Greek is the idea of athleticism. The same way that a person, if he's more athletic, the higher he performs or the greater he has in talent, the more that when he goes into competition, he faces off against stronger adversaries. He's no longer competing at like the little, you know, at the little, like the children's level. He's competing at the Olympic level where he's facing the best of the best. We see it in the same way when it comes to our spiritual struggle. I hope that answers the question of the person. Fanan is asking, my second question, Father, on the cross, our Lord Jesus Christ said, oh my God, why are you forsaken me? Does that mean he troubled with his faith for a moment? No. This isn't actually a depiction of the Lord asking, you know, why have you left me, or him declaring that God the Father has at this point turned away. This is the fulfillment of the prophecies, because those words were spoken by the prophet long before the Lord Jesus Christ. But in his humanity, he speaks on behalf of all human beings. The same way that he thirsts on behalf of all human beings, the same way that he is baptized on behalf of all human beings, the same way that he receives the Spirit on behalf of all human beings, the same way that he dies on behalf of all human beings, he speaks these words on behalf of humanity that has alienated itself from God. We have turned away from God. We have been cast out of that paradise, that Garden of Eden. The cherub stood there and held the fiery sword, and we could no longer enter because we turned our backs to God. And so this is the cry of humanity that says, Lord, Lord, why have you forsaken me? But in truth, it is not him who has forsaken us as much as it is us who have turned our backs on him. And so again, this is just another fulfillment of the prophecies where the Lord speaks on behalf of all humanity in order to heal humanity. Because it is now the human being's cry, the desire of the heart to say, come back to me. I want to be back with you. This is why he is capable of saying the very final words on the cross. He's capable of saying what? It is fulfilled. Because now he said and done everything on behalf of humanity. After he dies, he resurrects, he ascends, he sends the Holy Spirit. I hope that answers the question. Father, can you help me understand why it was more difficult to go to heaven before Jesus? Actually, it wasn't more difficult to go to heaven. It was impossible to go to heaven. You see, this is where it gets very important, my beloved. We have to understand why it was impossible and paradise was closed. And by the way, we make a difference between paradise and heaven. The kingdom of heaven will only be opened after the final judgment. Right now, those who have passed away in the Lord, we use the word interchangeably. We say, you know, oh, so-and-so has died and gone to heaven. We're actually speaking of paradise. Those people are in paradise with the Lord. And that's why when the righteous thief tells him, remember me, O Lord, when you come into your kingdom, what does the Lord answer him? Today, you will be with me in paradise, right? But before that, nobody got to go to paradise. Everybody was in the same reality. Hades had been ruling over all the souls because death was not conquered. Death, this great enemy that St. Paul speaks about, was finally destroyed. How? Through the death of our Lord Jesus Christ. That's why in the hymnology of the Orthodox Church, we say Christ is risen from the dead, trampling down death by death. That the way that he destroyed the enemy that used to send us all to Hades was by dying, by meeting death face to face, by taking death and destroying it through his life-giving resurrection. So my beloved, heaven or paradise in this case, if we're speaking more accurately, it was inaccessible to us because we weren't reconciled. We needed a God who was incarnate to reconcile us to the Father, to receive the Holy Spirit on our behalf, to show us the glory of the transfiguration so we can see what we were called to be, to minister to us, to teach to us, to die on the cross, to rise from the dead, to ascend into the heavens, to to place himself at the right hand of the Father so we can have a place in heaven when the time is right. All of these things need to be fulfilled. I urge the person who's asking the question, if you listen to one of the videos that we did on the Feast of Ascension, you'll have a better idea of why this was so important. So listen to the video on the Feast of Ascension, and it'll tell you why it is that the Lord did that so he can prepare a place for us. There's a question that says, why was the snake in the Garden of Eden in the first place? Does that mean that the human journey was planned? So the problem that I have is that when we ask this question, we are going to be obliged to question and to see, you know, how much of it is literal, how much of it is allegorical. You know, did the snake really talk? There's nothing wrong with snakes. God created those creatures. The problem is not the snake. But it talks about how it is that the serpent, St. Paul, when he refers to that serpent of old, he's referring to who? He's referring to Satan. It's not the snake that's the problem. It's a devil that introduces the idea of temptation and sin into our minds. So I guess the real question is, what was he there for, right? And I guess then we then have to try to answer the question, is it allegorical? Is it literal? And then we're going to find so many different opinions, and we're going to find that even the fathers, there's no clear consensus on this. Many of the fathers believe it to be literal. Other fathers clearly point to the fact that it's allegorical. What we know for sure is the following. If humanity was given an option, was tempted to stray away from that option, and in the process made the wrong choice, even though God had warned them and set them up to succeed. And so this wasn't, like, the question that we should be asking is not what was the snake doing there. The question we should be asking is that why didn't Adam and Eve know any better? They were specifically told, of all the trees of the garden, you may freely eat. I mean, this was all for you. Like, my beloved, I need you to consider this for just a second. It's not like God said, listen, there's one tree in this garden that if you eat from it, you're going to die, but I'm not going to tell you which one it was. Let's just hope you don't pick the wrong one. He doesn't say, okay, listen, there's some trees that I've poisoned and some trees that I've left good. I'm not going to tell you which one is which. You're just going to have to like hope that it works out for you. That's not what God did. God gives them the entire garden, all of creation. He tells them, you may freely eat of all of them, but that one tree that I pointed out to you, don't touch it. And don't eat, because the day you will eat of it, you will surely die. And I don't want you to die. That's why I'm warning you. So the question isn't, what was the devil doing here? The devil is a being that exists just like we do. And he's out to get us. The problem is not the devil. The problem is me. Why do I keep falling in those tracks? I was told by God, this is what leads to life. This is what leads to death. And you have much more access to life than you do to that one tree that might lead to death. Stay away from it. But the problem is that Eve listened and she believed and she convinced her husband and he ate. And they both, in that moment, rejected the Lord. So I don't have a problem with the serpent. I have a problem with human free will, who in my case constantly leads me back to the same sins that I should be struggling against. So this is interesting. The person is saying, you know, many black people don't believe in Jesus or go to church because all they see is white Jesus when the Bible says that he is black. Who is lying, the Bible or the church? Well, Jesus wasn't white and he wasn't black. I mean, the Bible is very clear. He was a Middle Eastern Jew. Middle Eastern Jews aren't black, and Middle Eastern Jews are definitely not, you know, white-skinned. But this has nothing to do with race, because obviously, I mean, if you go on Google right now and you do some research, you know, there is iconography of Jesus as Japanese. There's iconography of Jesus as a native redskin. There is a iconography of Jesus as a black person from Africa, from Ethiopia, from Eritrea. There's iconography of Jesus where he looks very clearly Middle Eastern. There's iconography of Jesus where he looks like he's Irish, red hair, blue eyes, pale skin, beautiful in, you know, this way or that way, and beautiful as the black Jews, beautiful as the Japanese Jews, beautiful as... The reason why people do this is because they relate to Jesus as their own. And that's the message of the gospel. Salvation is offered to us because Jesus is ours. Historical Jesus was a Middle Eastern Jew. He was probably darker skinned than the average white person, but no, he wasn't an African black person either. He was neither this nor that. So the question of who is lying, the Bible or the church, no one's really intentionally lying about anything. Everyone is depicting Jesus in the way that they know how. We're not interested in trying to formulate a perfect picture of Christ because all of these pictures are wrong. All of these icons are not meant to say this is what his physical traits look like. All of these icons actually point to the fact that we believe in the incarnate Word of God. The fact that we can portray Him through painting, through iconography, is a demonstration that we believe that He actually became man. So if anybody is struggling at the level of, I can't relate to Jesus because he's a man, or I can't relate to Jesus because he was a Jew, or I can't relate to Jesus because he wasn't black, no, my beloved, I urge you, please don't let those things get in the way of salvation. Read the message of the gospel. Read the message of the Holy Spirit that was given to us through Scripture. Read the words of Christ. Let them set you free. There is no room for racism. There is no room for xenophobia. There is no room for hatred and any sort of partiality. Jesus is accessible to all of us. He is Lord of all creation, of all creation. He is the infinite and eternal Word of God who existed before all times. Yes, He was incarnate. Yes, He became a man. Yes, He was a Jewish Middle Eastern man born in Nazareth. And yes, He did all of these things for us and for our salvation. Does that somehow then translate into, I guess He prefers Middle Eastern men? No, of course not. And there's no reason to view it like that. Or else He wouldn't have told His disciples, go and spread the gospel to the ends of the world and baptize all nations in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. This would not have been the case either when the Holy Spirit tells St. Philip in the book of Acts chapter 8, it tells Philip, go to the Ethiopian eunuch, overtake his chariot, speak to him the words of salvation. And Philip goes to the Ethiopian eunuch, who was a man of high authority working under the queen of Ethiopia by the name of Candace. And right there and then he is baptized. The Holy Spirit, God led Philip for that one man. God has no partiality. He is there for the Jew, for the Greek, for the Gentile, for the black person, the white person. He is there for all races, all genders, all age. And we shouldn't try to put Jesus in a bucket and say he's only for these people. God forbid that we should speak in that way. God forbid. I hope that answers the question of the person who asked it. There is a question that says, did the prophets before Christ go to heaven, or were they in Hades? Hades. Hades. We have no reason to believe that anybody was in paradise. Everyone was in Hades. And you can actually see this very clearly in the parable of Lazarus and the rich man. Right? The rich man who dies and ends up in Hades, he's in the same location as Father Abraham. There is a gulf between them. There is a separation between them, but he's in the same place because he sees Father Abraham afar off. And he says, please send Father Abraham to just dip his finger in the water and to bring it and quench my thirst. The parable very clearly shows that they're all in the same location. They weren't separated in that sense. And so there is no reason for us to believe that paradise was accessible to anyone. And as a matter of fact, St. Peter, in his epistle, talks about how it is that the Lord even preached the gospel to those who are in Hades when he left it barren, when he went and he took all of the souls of the righteous. Question says, if the devil had once a humility, would God forgive him? Absolutely. this is not even questionable in the church. If the devil had it in him to be able to repent, of course. Our God is unchanging. And if he is willing to accept the repentance of me, one of his creatures in his image and his likeness, then he's also capable of receiving it from any of his creatures. The problem is that when we speak of Satan, is that we believe truly that he is incapable of repenting because he was not created in God's image and likeness. We are created in God's image and likeness. He was a cherub who fell. And if you read this passage in the book of Isaiah, it talks about how it is that he was adorned with glory, that he was called the morning star, which means Lucifer, or Lucifer, which means the morning star. And yet he fell away because he desired to be even higher than God. And because he is unrepentant, because he was so filled with pride, and tradition actually tells us that he took a third of the celestial beings with him when he fell. He had no intention on repenting. Our God is a God who is love. And so by definition, had there been a repentance, it could have been accepted. But that question doesn't lead us anywhere, because we know that Satan is incapable of repenting. Is it possible for a non-believing person to go to heaven if their family pray for them? I believe that people who are even unbelieving are capable of going to heaven, but only through their own demeanor and integrity and through their own pursuit of truth. St. Paul makes this very clear in the book of Romans when he talks about how it is that they have become a law unto themselves, that there are people who have received the law and so they will be judged by the law. But there are people who have not received the law. They have not heard of the good news of the gospel. And so in the process, they will be judged based on what they know. Is it possible for me to pray hard enough to somehow make God not look at a person's intentions in life and choices? That's not what the church believes. The church prays and asks for God's mercy because it knows that God will always be as merciful as he ought to be and can be in his justice and in his mercy. But can I somehow pray so hard for a person who has rejected God his entire life and doesn't want to be with God and make God force that person to live with him? No. If that person deeply desires not to know the truth, deeply desires to not want to be with God, then God will not force himself upon them. But is it possible for a person who does not know God as formally as we do, who has not received, you know, the good news of salvation the way that we have, is it possible for God to save them? Well, according to St. Paul, that God will judge them according to what they do know, which tells us that, yes, there is a law that has been embedded within the human being, the human conscience that is created under the formula of God's image and likeness, is capable of knowing God, even though it doesn't express who God is as accurately as we might as Christians. So we can only hope in God's mercy. And we know that his mercy is great. And we know that he will judge us according to his mercy. And we pray that he judges according to his mercy, not according to our sins. May God have mercy on us and all of his creation. There's a question that says, why is it harder to strengthen our faith than to fall? I mean, let's take the most basic example of, you know, gravity, right? It is so much easier to go down a hill than it is for us to go up a hill. It is easier for us to stay seated than for us to get up. It is easier to go down a set of stairs than it is for us to go up the set of stairs. You know, it's interesting, my beloved, because obviously, oftentimes what we are suffering is the fact that we are tempted to stay down when we fall. And this is so important because we're oftentimes thinking to ourselves, what's the point? You know, I fell, I keep falling, I've confessed it once, twice, three times, four times over. Nothing seems to be changing. The most important piece of this is for us to realize that God is not going to ask us, how many times did you fall? God is going to ask us, why didn't you get up? I gave you the means necessary. I wanted you to succeed. I wanted you to be able to enjoy life and to have life at its fullest, that you may have life and have it more abundantly, he says in the Gospel of John. So my beloved, the real question is, why do we stay down? Right? Why don't we get up? Especially when grace is so accessible to us and God's mercy and strength is so accessible to us. There's no reason for us to stay face down in the mud. On the contrary, by his grace and through the workings of the Holy Spirit and the faithfulness of his promises, he has told us that he will never turn back a sinner who comes to him, that he desires not the death of the sinner, but rather that he returns and lives. These are the words of Scripture. And so it might be easier for us to fall, and it might be harder to get up, but at the same time, it's not very complicated, is it? Get up and go to him. Get up and tell him, Lord, I want to be better for you. I want to stop this sin. I want to prevent myself from being separated from you. I want to live in your presence. I want to live for you. I want to glorify your name. And that could truly set us on a path where we can potentially begin a lifetime of reconciliation, of repentance, and of union with God. There's a question that says, if God does not experience emotions as we do, then what do scriptures mean by love and wrath? A very good question. God is the author of everything that it means to be human, because he designed us and he created us. And big part of who the human being is being a psychosomatic union. As you know, human beings are psychosomatic. We are both soul and spirit, mind, body, and spirit, right? So because we are psychosomatic, a big part of our psyche is our emotions as well. And so we were meant to have emotions. The problem is when the emotions run wild. The problem is when the emotions reach a point where, rather than serving their purpose as God has intended, they become the very things that tie us down. They become the very things that take over our lives. We become a person who doesn't use emotion in a way to connect and to be relational. We become a person who uses emotion as a weapon against another person. We manipulate ourselves and we manipulate others. We are overwhelmed with our emotions. And so emotions are not in and of themselves evil, because God is the author of emotions. But is God emotional the way that we understand emotion? Is he filled with passion the way that we are filled with passion? No, because our expression of emotion and passions is one that has been corrupted because of the fallen nature. Whereas God is love. God can be angry without sinning. There is such a thing as the wrath of God towards evil only. But when we hear wrath, we think of what we would typically do. You know, a person who gets really angry, he's fuming, his eyes are bloodshot. He looks at another person and he desires to hurt him, and to even, like, we say stuff like, oh, if I ever I see him, I'm going to do this and that. And that's what we imagine as wrath. That is a very fallen and corrupt understanding of that. The wrath of God is expressed towards unrighteousness. It is expressed strictly towards evil, not upon those who are suffering the evil, but rather the substance itself that needs to be destroyed. Not that evil has a substance, but rather evil in the sense where God wants to eradicate evil and unrighteousness in order that we might have life. He doesn't desire to kill us. There's a difference between a doctor who wants to destroy the cancer inside a person and who wants to destroy the person who has cancer. Those are two very different things. We sometimes think that God's wrath is at the level of he wants to destroy the person who has cancer. That's not true. He wants to destroy the cancer that's killing the person. Same thing for love. We don't say that God is loving. We don't say that God is lovely. We say that God is love. He is the author of that love. As a matter of fact, the fathers say something beautiful. They say he is the lover, the beloved, and love itself. All of those things. The Trinity is the Father who has loved, the Son who is the beloved, and the Spirit who is love that dwells within us. Right? God is the author of all of those things. So it's not that God has no emotion. Is that the idea of emotion within God is not at all the way that we understand it. And God is definitely not moody or emotional the way that we are. I hope that answers your question, Yaakov. Father, in the Bible, Jesus says, anyone who starts to plow and looks back is no use for the kingdom of God. So when I started to live after the commandment of God and fell miserably again, could I start again? Yes, of course. The idea of anyone who starts to plow and looks back is no use for the kingdom of God is the very idea of trying to tell you and me, don't look back. Keep your eyes forward. But if I do look back and I fail, what is this commandment telling me? Go back to work. Go back to work. The book of Proverbs actually says the righteous person falls seven times and arises seven times. How is a person righteous if he falls seven times? Book of Proverbs says that's not what makes him righteous. Righteousness is not based on whether or not you fall. Righteousness is on whether or not you keep getting up. This very specific passage is spoken within the context to tell us, don't look back, move forward, right? The same way that Elijah tells his disciple Elisha, let the dead bury the dead. What do I have to do with you? Right? This whole idea of being able to realize that we must look forward. We must not dwell on the past. We must not let anything hold us down. It is from the same spirit that the Lord tells us, unless a person hates father, mother, brother, sister, husband, wife, children, or even his own soul, he cannot carry the cross and come and follow me and be my disciple. Is he asking us to hate all of those people? No. He's saying that if you love any of them more than me, you will never be able to follow me to the fullest of your capacity. Observant the Orthodox says, Hi, Abuna, I experience too much guilt to face God when I fall so many times. Sometimes it feels like I take advantage of God's mercy, which makes it hard for me to face him sometimes. I want you to understand, my dear beloved brother or sister, forgive me, I'm not sure. I want you to understand truly. This is going to sound very bad, but I just need you to bear with me, okay? The reason why we believe in an incarnate Lord, the reason why we believe that God became man, is not so that God can come and put himself on display. I mean, St. Athanasius says this beautifully. St. Athanasius of Alexandria, Athanasius the Apostolic, he says that God did not come to put himself on display, but rather he came to put himself at the disposal of men and women who are sick, who are ill, who are corrupted, who have sinned, who have fallen. What does that mean? He has put himself at our disposal. He didn't come so that we can all applaud him and say, oh, look, there's God in the flesh. He's so beautiful. Take a picture of him. No, he didn't come to just make a display. He came to put himself at our disposal. Meaning what? He came and he tells you and me, use me. I am truth. Come and use me. I am the way. Come and use me. I am the life. Come and take me. I am the bread of life, which gives life to the world. Come, participate in all that I am. He comes and he says, use me. That's what I am here for. That's what I am here for. Sometimes I feel like we treat God as if we don't like owing him anything. We owe him everything. Everything. We will never be able to pay him back. So there's no reason for us to have a sense of pride at the level of, I can't face him. What am I going to tell him? It's the 20th time. It's the 30th time. It's the 1,000th time. God is not counting, my beloved. He's there and he's saying, I have an infinite source of love, of grace, of mercy. I have all of this to give you. Stop acting as if you're asking for too much. You are mine. You are mine. You are my son, my daughter. I am king and you are the child of the king. Do not overthink it. Keep coming back. Keep coming back. And like that little child, tell him, I messed up, but I want to be back. And he'll say, perfect, come back. There's always room. God is not looking down on us and saying, listen, how long are you going to keep doing this for? Because I feel like you're abusing me. That's not the God that we believe in at all. Look at the story of the prodigal son in Luke 15. It doesn't say that the father was there and he was upset and he's like, no, you took the money and you spoiled it. I want you to live outside as a servant for the next 3 months and then we can see if you come into the house. That's not how the father treated the son. It said that the father was there waiting for him, and when he saw the prodigal son afar off, he ran to him. He ran to him, he fell on his neck, he kissed him, he put sandals on his feet, a robe around him, a ring on his finger. He killed the fatted calf and he celebrated. And what were his words? My son was once lost and now is found. He was dead and now he is alive. There's no reason for us to question God's loving mercy and care and compassion for us. He is truly the infinite and eternal and almighty God. And there's no reason for us to think that somehow we're using up all of his resources. He wants to give us all that he is. My beloved, it's always so good to spend time with all of you. It's always so good for us to share in these moments where we can ask our questions and where we can learn from each other and with each other. I ask you to please remember to keep praying for this project and keep praying for, you know, for the entire world, that the Lord may reveal his light and his life. May he reveal the truth to all those people who are suffering, who have strayed away from him. Please remember to pray for the world and to pray for us as we also pray for you.